We have been remiss in cascading magisterial teachings to our people because of the lack of materials, lack of resources. Well, Father has been doing that kind of work, publishing not only articles, but of course the regular Word and Life, which hopefully we can subscribe, as well as the different documents of the Church. In recent years, we have been recipient of various encyclicals from the Pope, as well as from our own bishops. And our speaker has gone beyond simply publishing the encyclical or pastoral letter, has provided for us, after the document, a glossary, guide questions, as well as leading questions. So without further ado, our speaker on how to cascade magisterial teachings and how to package magisterial teachings in words as well as in concepts understandable to our people. Kindly welcome in our midst, Reverend Father Salvatore Puzzo of the Salesians of the Apostle.
Thank you, Monsignor. Good morning. I'm here. I know I saw some of your faces a long time ago. Some of you are getting old. I am not. So to speak. But you can hear from my voice that I am indeed getting old. It's part of dying a little bit every day. But events like this keep me alive. As I was preparing for this meeting, I revisited my work in Elche. That's almost 14 years ago when I left Elche. And then all the time that I spent with Archbishop Legazpi, with Bishop Bishop Sorovinas, and Bishop, well, you see, one of my memory blocks, Bishop, a Jesuit. So I worked with the Jesuits, I worked with the Dominicans. I'm in a way also a product of the Jesuits. I studied communication with the Jesuits. When I was studying theology in Ireland, my professors were very fond of Karl Rahner, and so he had to digest the theological investigations and other things, which in those days I was wondering why should I be wasting my time with this guy. But evermore I learned a lot, and now I am living in a way, deriving benefits from the effort that we made in those days to understand those theologians like Rahner or the other people whose sometimes names are a bit controversial, etc. But I'm here today not to speak about myself, but about the documents of the Magisterium. Originally, Monsignor Jerry had asked me to come and tell to you something about the work I've been doing on the for the past 10 years on encyclicals and apostolic exhortations of the popes. But then, from the title of the theme, from the theme I received, it seems it is a wider one, so I widen my perception. So the title for today is, so it is the magisterial documents. So I just in 2 or 3 minutes I give you the summary, and then if you like I can continue. If not, you can start the asking questions. So I will be giving you a short panoramic of the magisterial documents of the Church, Universal Church, and what we have here in the Philippines. It's something precious that we should never forget and should appreciate properly. Then I will ask a question. How is it that these documents that are so precious, so rich in content, are so little known? What are the reasons? That's the first question. Second, how can we overcome these difficulties? And then at that stage, I will Then you, the contribution that World Life Publications has been making in view of overcoming the basic difficulty, that is bringing the documents of the Church as close as possible to our people and to create study aids that enable priests, catechists, religion teachers to cascade, as Monsignor was saying earlier, to ordinary people the essence of the content so that in turn they may live those messages and share it with their own children or classroom and so on. So that will be my outline, and if you like, I can continue. Is that okay with you? Well, I'm glad that I have our youngest member today is the bishop. You must be the youngest, right? Unless we have anybody younger than Bishop Magalia? You are younger? Anyway, it's good to have a bishop, so if I say some heresy, Bishop, please don't accuse me right away. All right, so you remember, let's move. How to make the most of the documents of the Magisterium. That is the overall objective. And we are here, and I'm here, to try and see how we can make the most. But first of all, let us see what these documents are. Okay? So, the main document of the Magisterium in the recent history of the Church. We live really in a very fortunate time. Our popes have issued a number of documents that has been, of course, Vatican II that has produced those 16 documents. They are an immense mine of doctrine. And the question is how to digest the content, how to put it into practice. A tradition in the Catholic Church that is to issue official documents for the information and formation of the faithful. Notice these two words, information and formation of the faithful. Yara, all of you are much younger than me. And I believed in the time also of Pius XII, and then John the 23rd, but especially on Pius XII, he also issued many encyclicals, but they are usually short. One thing that strikes us is the traditional encyclicals were short, sometimes 32 pages, 48 pages. Then there came, when it started a little bit with John the 23rd and the two famous encyclicals, you remember? The first encyclical, famous one was? Can you? Pacem Terris, I think there was one before that. Mater, yeah, Magistra. The first that really shook the world was Mater and Magistra. Then there came a crisis, I think you still remember the crisis. The missile crisis, that was a great danger that the world might enter a third world war, and the Pope wrote Pacem in Terris. That was in 1963, if I recall. Anyway, so the tradition to issue these documents, usually encyclicals or apostolic letters and so on. And the topics were doctrine, or historical events or anniversary that have a special significance for the entire Church or sizable part of it. There were encyclicals about certain events, anniversary, 25th anniversary of a congregation or about a holy year and so on. And then the Pope issued bulls, apostolic letters, apostolic exhortations, encyclicals, etc. And instead, the bishops in their own dioceses, they issued the pastoral letters and ordinances on topics and events that are especially relevant to their own diocese. They still do that. They still do that, fortunately, and they are very beautifully crafted. Then, since Vatican II, we have the national regional episcopal conferences, which also issue official documents and pronouncements for the faithful over their respective circumscriptions. Especially in South America, they produce a lot of very precious material. No? I mentioned something here. So the document of Puebla, social problems. Medellin, likewise, then Aparecida, that's the Holy Father, Pope Francis quotes many times in his encyclicals. And then we have something that was of interest to us as the bishops gathered to study the problems of different areas in the world. We have ecclesia in Asia, likewise there was ecclesia in Africa and Europe, and so on. Again, a mine of information of Christian perception and guidelines on how to go about it. Now, we have important collections of church documents. All of you, do you have a copy of the Denzinger, Schoenmaker? Do you have a copy of it? Denzinger, the copy of a collection of the documents of the church. How many of you have it? How many? One? Two? Oh, you should all have one. It's a beautiful collection. Well, it was started, as usual, by Germans. They are very particular, selecting excerpts from important documents of the church from the very beginning, starting with the creeds and so on. Very interesting. And it is a reference book for all those who want to write about doctrine and morals. So, the title is Ecclesiam Symbolorum, Definitionum et Declarationum, the Rebus Fidei et Morum, should be faith and morals, but actually 99% is about the doctrine, and they put some of morality, because the church has not issued, any infallible document on moral life, this ordinary magisterium. Instead, when it comes to doctrine, especially in the first three centuries, there are so many statements stating this is heretical, this is right, and then there came the Council of Trent to add it also. Then, okay, by the way, that is in Greek and Latin, that's no problem for you, right? Yes?
Yes.
I hope you studied the Greek, did you? First bishop thing, you know, when you become a bishop, you don't know Greek. And then Latin, all of you, can you talk Latin also? But sister, you are not expected to because you are a sister. Okay, then the documents of Vatican II. I have here a display of material of the documents of Vatican II. You still remember the one that was published by the Doctor of St. Paul? And this has been, five or six years ago, published by Father Kruger, James Kruger, revised or re-edited the content of the Doctrine of Vatican II. The clericians, they did not want to be outdone, so they published also their version. So now we have two versions of the documents of Vatican II. All right, next. And then there is a book that's very important. How many of you have a copy of it? Sister Rhea, okay, very good. Father, yes? No more? Oh, yes, good. Excellent. You will agree with me that's a real treasure. A real treasure. Huh? Well, it was all started by, it was a Karl, then a Jesuit, then two other Jesuits who continued the work after Karl Rader left it, Neumann Dupuy. And the original title was The Teaching of the Catholic Church. Then it was expanded thanks to the collaboration of other good professors of theology, and was given the new title, The Christian Faith. Now this has reached the seventh edition, because periodically, Dupuy now is the only, I think he also died. The only one survived, but I think he died maybe 1 or 2 years ago. He was more than 90 years of age. As the new documents come, they get the best, the most significant parts, and they put them in the category, in the different parts of the book where they belong. It's a precious thing. I inquired from India if they have a newest edition. No. So the latest edition is the 2000, year 2000. But it is really, for me, it's the best help for priests and also for students of theology. Sister Rhea, am I right? Yes, okay. Yes. Then after Document Vatican II, all of you know the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And after that, there was the various compendia or compendiums. I have here the whole display here, the compendium of the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And then tomorrow you will hear on this afternoon, when is that? The presentation of UCAT, which is a youth version of the CCC, done in a very masterly way, a very beautiful presentation, very attractive, and I'm glad to learn that ENCE has now the authority permission to distribute it throughout the Philippines, and there are going to be seminars tomorrow. I think there will be an orientation on how to use it. That's a very important thing. Okay, then that is Lukat. So that comprehended is another summary of the that's a compendium of the social doctrine of the Church, not again presented in a youthful manner. Then we have the really an ocean of encyclicals, apostolic exhortations, apostolic letters by starting with the Leo the 13th. You remember the encyclical, famous encyclical Leo the 13th, Rerum Novarum. Well, that was really, in a way, the first time that the Church paid attention to the great social movements of the time and gave the position of the Church. And from then on, the Pope was very attentive to when it is 25 years, 50 years after, and so on. They keep the flame burning, and they update the vision of the Church. That's a very, very interesting work. Right. Then we come to the Philippines. The Philippines also have a very precious material. And most of this is done through pastoral letters issued by the CBCP on a great variety of topics. I still remember the one, and it was also supported by the Holy Father in Laudato Si, our bishop's letter, what is happening to our beautiful land. I remember I was in ENCE and we discussed several points with Archbishop Legazpi, the one who wanted that letter, and he had asked his sister to draft the first draft. Very interesting. And then other things of population control and so on, and then the beautiful pastoral letter presenting the ITER, the journey to be made by the Philippine Church in preparation for the 500th anniversary of the Christianization. It's very beautifully crafted, that one was. Then the document and decree of PCP2, followed by the National Pastoral Plan. I read even recently again the document of PCP2. Our bishops and our locals who participate there really, in many cases, were 20 years ahead of the Church. Many things that were treated there, the popes took them back again and developed them 20 years after. Very interesting, including the one attention to the environment as well. Okay, then the National Catechetical Directory of the Philippines, NCDP, entitled Maturing in Christian Faith, that is 1984, and that was also the year when ECCE started preparing the National Catechism, which was going to be called Catechism for Filipino Catholics. In that catechism that's been translated into several vernacular, Tagalog, Cebuano, Ilonggo, Ilocano. I hope that in ENCE you still have a copy of those translations. Then CBCP letter and statements. That's about all that I can offer you about, because I inquired even recently from CBCP if there has been a sequel to that collection of letters, and the answer was, sorry, no. And I said, too bad. Then I said, if you can help to bring it about, because those letters are really a thermometer of the national situation, problems, and what the Church thinks about them, and it would be useful for formation houses, especially in all Catholic schools, to have a copy of those collections. Up to now, we have only from 1984 to 1990. Now, evaluation. So the first impression that one gathers from this short overview of what exists is a great abundance of documents of the magisterium. There are almost hundreds. And each one of them is a masterpiece in its own right. Now, these documents are also characterized by great richness and variety of content. Now, all these documents of the magisterium are a real encyclopedia of Catholic faith. A real encyclopedia. However, the Pope and bishops over the last 120 years have done a good job in the fulfillment of their mission as teachers of the faith and evangelizers. However, there are some relevant questions, and they are. Are all these precious documents sufficiently known by the faithful? A very subtle question. What's your opinion? Are they? What do you say? Can we say, even though we priests, we educators, we catechists, that we know well these documents? What's your opinion? No commitment? Would you agree? Would you agree that we have not done justice to most of these documents? Yes, when they are issued, there is a flurry of activities and seminars and so on. After a while, never mind. And so we forget about them. That's enough. A reality check reveals the sad fact, with very few exceptions, many of them are not known at all, or are known in another superficial way. An inevitable related question, why are not these documents sufficiently known? There are some reasons. I try to identify some, they are not, that's not exhausting, no? Okay, the causes are valid. Many of them are written in a language that is too far above the heads of ordinary Catholic. That is one of our problems. When the Pope or the Bishop sometimes write, they use a language that is understood already by, obviously by other bishops, by professors of theology and so on. But ordinary people, after one paragraph or two, say, that's not for me. It's too far about, too technical sometimes. Now, Pope Francis has made things a little simpler, no? But other popes, they are popes, and they have to maintain a certain scholarship, you know, scholarly style and so on. But then that would have needed a sort of what we call mediation to be made more popular, easier to understand, simplification to be brought to the masses. And many times that did not happen. Another cause is the unattractive presentation of such documents as their very source, the Vatican, Episcopal Conference, and bishops. What do I mean by that? Well, is there some example? No. You see, when the Vatican publishes encyclicals, this is what comes out. Who feels attracted by a book like this? Now we live in a period of competition where images, where the cover of a book can make or unmake the book. Right? And this is what it was distributed all over the world, except the copies that are sent to heads of state, members of the diplomatic corps, they get it in coated paper, a beautiful color cover. But even the bishops here, this is what they receive. This is what they receive. Look at that. Can you read the title? Can you read the title? Voila! How can you feel attracted to know what is inside the book? If the cover itself is not attractive. I think we have to learn this lesson. The world of today progresses through advertisements and creating an image. This does not create a positive image. I want to just But that's not the whole story yet. No? I'd like to just give you another example. In the documents coming from the Vatican, like this, you open the book. You don't know what the document is called. You don't know what chapter you are in. This is simple book design that they should know. The guys who read this, I don't expect the Pope to ever hand even in these details. But the ones in charge of producing it should know the ABC of the book design. They fail. So it is not always the fault of the poor parish priests or the poor Catholics. Some defects, some shortcomings are there at the top. And unfortunately, when they are produced locally, what do they do? Since Rome is our leader, they reproduce the same thing. The dots of St. Paul, the only thing that they change is the cover. They put the cover in four corners. But inside, it's exactly the same. No title of the book inside, no title of the chapters. Likewise, other publishers in the Philippines, I don't know what happens in other countries, but this is a sad story. Now, despite the importance attached to the documents and the objectives of those documents, their editorial and typographical presentation is the very denial of such importance and reference. It's like having a pearl and using a tattered piece of a newspaper to wrap the pearl. I know that not much the pearl, but the pearl should be presented as it deserves. In this we fail. Now the shabby appearance that starts with the front cover and is followed through in the poor book design already mentioned with no headers, no footers, and sometimes even using endnotes rather than footnotes. That means when there is the text at the bottom of the page, you would expect the footnotes. No, to save time, they put them all at the end. They still call them footnotes, they should be called endnotes, which is very impractical. I am on page 53 and footnote number 74. It's number 74. Who takes time to do that? The best, the most rational thing would be to really put the footnotes on the page where they belong. Now, in that respect, the Vatican edition is okay. But there are some additional documents printed here, even in the Philippines, where they will put all the notes at the end. Is that an incentive? Is that to be reader-friendly? Of course not. That's the bad. Just to give you the example, you see, no headers means that on the left side we should have the title of the book. It isn't there. On the right, we should know what chapter we are in. It isn't there. So the absence of pictures. Again, inside, no pictures. Recently, a few years ago, the Osservatore Romano, when it publishes the documents of the church, inserts also some pictures in the Osservatore Romano. But in the official document, in book form, voila, no pictures. Bad. The whole thing becomes unfriendly. Now, some of the local editions will follow that style, all right, with the exception of the front cover in text. Now, still another almost absence of supporting literature, and then we are getting close home now. The simple didactic aids that would enable group leaders and teachers and catechists to lead their audience into a pleasant discovery and assimilation of the content of the document. It's not enough to produce a beautiful document. We would need, internationally and locally, a literature that really gives you additional information. Why does that document come now? What preceded it? What are the main objectives? How can we make it relevant to our condition here? These are important things. Very little reproduced like that in the Philippines. Very little indeed. Yes, some information when the document is launched, maybe reproducing the when what was done, when they say the latest encyclicals like Laudato Si and what is the teacher